I just saw one of the craziest hacking demos I think I've ever seen. I saw it last night. I almost dropped what I was doing to drive into the studio to record this video. It's one of the more clever tactics I think I've ever seen to hack somebody. And I'm really glad what I'm about to show you was written by a security researcher and we're not talking about an incident. I'm gonna explain the research and then I wanna show you this video demo because my jaw literally dropped when I watched this. And then I wanna get into my personal history with these kind of techniques. When we get to that part, fair warning, jump scare of baby Matt from over 15 years ago. It looks like somebody found me off the street with my puka shell necklace on, stuck a suit on me, and put me on stage to talk about this kind of hacking that I'm going to talk about right now that's still relevant over 15 years later. The research write-up that I initially saw that put me onto this was called Polymorphic Extensions. The crux of this hack has to do with the kinds of permissions that browser extensions wind up having. If you've ever installed a browser extension or even like a mobile app, you'll get that screen that says, hey, these are the permissions that the app you're about to install has. Most people probably ignore it, but even if you pay attention to this kind of stuff, if you want to use some of these extensions that are genuinely useful, they do have permissions to things like all of your information in any tab, or permission to open a new window, permission to your location. There are popular browser extensions right now that are basically keyloggers that are AI powered and help you with your grammar and your writing. But in order to do that, they need permission to everything you type into your browser. I'm not saying don't ever use browser extensions with crazy permissions, but you do need to understand the threat here. So I wanna go into this attack first, I'll show you the demo, and then we'll talk a little bit more about browser security in general. The reason this research is called polymorphic extensions is the technique that I'm talking about that really impressed me. The gist of it is they made a malicious extension, but that it had legitimate usefulness. If users downloaded this extension, it would have permissions to do everything that we're about to talk about, including morphing itself into what looks like another extension that you have installed, say 1Password, your password manager, and tricking you to giving them their information. This research talks about it in phases. Phase one, basically getting you to install the extension. Side note here that they don't mention that I talk a lot about in my old research is you don't necessarily need to get someone to install a malicious extension if you can find a vulnerability in a popular extension. There's been plenty of use cases of that. I'll show you some of them. But okay, phase one, install the extension. Phase two, and this is kind of tricky, figure out what target legitimate extensions they have installed in their browser. There is an API that lets them do this called chrome.management, but the Chrome extension system does not allow monitoring of other extensions installed without the use of this chrome.management API. But there are sneakier ways to do it. And a lot of websites do this for like legitimate reasons to protect themselves or their users from people using malicious tools against the website. One of those ways is looking for specific PNG files that might be installed in the user's browser. For example, do you find the 1Password logo? If that picture is lingering around, they likely have that extension installed. They even go to talk about how LinkedIn does this to try to check for scraping extensions. In order to do this, the malicious extension will inject some JavaScript into any running browser. This is something that a lot of extensions do, and it's just one of the permissions that they can get. And then here you can see in this example, if they run a script, they can actually check for the PNG hash of the picture of the 1Password logo and then respond back to their server and say, yep, found the 1Password logo. The result of that phase can then feed into phase three, figure out what the attack is actually gonna be, which is where we get into impersonating the target extension. I wanna show you the demo here. So here it goes, you gotta watch closely, but here's like the Chrome extension page and you can see your installed extensions on the top right. You'd see 1Password there, Google Translate, uBlock Origin, whatever it is, right? And then they're gonna go to the web store and install this malicious extension that they have uploaded to the store. As far as I know, this is research. This isn't like actual malicious stuff. They block it out because I don't think they want people downloading their purposely vulnerable extension. When I did my research, we literally called it evil hacker extension and it got approved. So this approval process isn't super stringent. They're going through, these are the permissions that it has, manage your apps, extensions, and themes, and see your browsing history. That's not even the craziest permissions that you possibly could have. But then here you go, they pin it to the top right, which they said was part of their social engineering attack, but it's very common for extensions that you're gonna use is to like pin it to your board up there. So that little arrow is the malicious extension that they pinned to the top. Now they're gonna go to Salesforce and log in, and this is where like 1Password would normally kick in. Did you miss it? It happened while I was just talking. They're gonna replay it really quick though. I missed it. I would have fallen for this. Check it out. They disable 1Password. The malicious extension logo turns into the 1Password logo and it says, hey, you've been logged out of 1Password. I'm gonna pause here a sec and I wanna go back and I wanna play it not zoomed in and in real time again so you can see how fast that all actually happened. This blew my mind. So, okay, ready? Watch the top right. They're gonna go to Salesforce and watch the extensions in the top right. Go to Salesforce, 1Password disabled. Their thing turns into 1Password. You're logged out. Holy crap, that happened so fast, okay? So they go and do the zoom in thing again, and then they do the log out, and then they prompt you. This actually happens if you're a 1Password user. Every once in a while, you have to re-authenticate. You don't always have to re-authenticate with your secret key like they're doing here, but this is part of the social engineering. It's like, oh man, my browser like fully unauthenticated from 1Password. I had to go find my secret key again and like retype it. I can see this working, right? Now they have your secret key, and then here's the even sneakier part. They re-enable 1Password as soon as you do it. I'm pausing it because 1Password comes right back and their extension turns back to normal. And then guess what? 1Password works like normal on the site after the login and they let you right in. That was insane. There's no way that this wouldn't be highly successful. Also, 1Password was just an example here. We could do this with a lot of different extensions. The research goes and talks about how this could happen with crypto wallets, which also make heavy use of extensions, maybe like banking apps or whatever. That I think that's just how you stole your passwords. But basically, the browser extension ecosystem is generally overly permissive. So if you find a popular extension that you could mimic the behavior of, that has a lot of permissions, you could morph your app into that app for a brief time and then trick the user into giving you some information. Okay, I did promise the jump scare. All right, so first and foremost, my PowerPoint skills have come a long way. So please do not judge my slides from this talk from Black Hat in 2011. Ah, first jump scare. Wow, really old PowerPoint slides. Okay, so yeah, I did this talk with a friend of mine, Kyle Osborne. We were working at White Hat Security at the time, and we got our hands on an early Chrome OS device. This was like Chromebooks before Chromebooks came out. It was called the CR48. It was a beta. They sent it to us to test for security issues, and we found one right away. If I remember correctly, I found the bug, and then Kyle helped me write the exploit for it during the research. The thing that was crazy at the time was like this whole browser extension ecosystem was just beginning. If you've ever used a Chromebook, you can't install apps on it like you normally would a regular laptop. It is just browser and cloud-based, which make them very secure all in all because you can't get like traditional malware on those things. You don't have any access to the hard drive. But to compensate for that and to make it still usable, they put out a ton of extensions. So one of the first pre-installed one was called Scratchpad. Basically, hey, you don't have notepad.exe on your Windows box? Well, we're gonna have this like note-taking app. It was pre-installed on all these Chromebooks. It was vulnerable to cross-site scripting and it had very broad permissions because basically this extension wanted to be able to run in any tab you had open to be able to take notes in that tab. So with cross-site scripting, in this one browser extension that came pre-installed on the first Chromebooks, I basically had universal cross-site scripting in any tab that I wanted to be able to open. The other part that was really cool about this bug was that it was zero click. If I shared a note with you to your G drive, it would auto sync to this notes app and the title was vulnerable to cross-site scripting. So you didn't have to click anything. You didn't have to accept anything. If I just sent you an email, my cross-site scripting payload fired. And because of the permissions, I was able to open any tabs, do pop unders, so you didn't even see the window going on. I could open a bunch of tabs and steal all your cookies. All right, you ready for jump scare number two? Okay, here I was on CNN talking about this live in Las Vegas. I'm gonna mute it, so I'm just gonna talk over it. Ah, okay, cool, baby Matt. Puka shell necklace and all. I remember my first suit. Okay, cool. What I was explaining here was basically everything I just explained, but Chromebooks were pretty new at the time. And so it was worth explaining to everybody, hey, this is like what browser extensions are. The reason I bring that all up is to not like brag that I was on CNN or anything. I was like a little kid at the time. I just want to say that this research is almost exactly relevant today. Yeah, that cross-site scripting bug was fixed, but just by the nature of how browser extensions need to work in order to give you the functionality that they need, if any of those browser extensions with those permissions has a cross-site scripting bug, you have universal cross-site scripting. So that's why I made that caveat in the beginning of the video. You don't necessarily need to trick someone into installing a malicious app. Say Grammarly had a bug, Or say some RSS reader had a bug. These apps inherently need access to all tabs and all data in those tabs. But these researchers are right. Even if you couldn't find a bug in a popular app, you could develop an actually useful extension that did this malicious stuff. That app that they showed was an actual AI marketing assistant or something like that. And then it just so happened to, for a brief time, morph into 1Password, steal your information, morph back into the AI marketing app, let 1Password work the way it did, and no one's the wiser. This has happened in real life before. Maybe not this whole morphing trick like I just saw, that was pretty crazy, but very popular apps have been compromised. This is in 2021. There was an app called The Great Suspender. It's basically trying to solve the fact that Chrome uses a ton of RAM. And then it wasn't hacked in the way that you might think. The owner of the extension sold it to an unidentified party who all of a sudden had an extension installed on millions of devices with broad permissions to those users' data. And that's the exact permissions that they saw as a goldmine to grab that data and use it for other purposes. So without users' consent, their data may have been siphoned out from under their noses is what this report talks about. There's many examples of this. Here's another one. I just searched really quick before I was making this video. I actually remember this one from 2018, this browser extension called Stylish. Again, it was pretty popular. And then all of a sudden it started stealing everyone's data. And once again, it wasn't hacked. It was acquired by a company called SimilarWeb. I think you've probably heard of them. And this extension had access to your browser history. So this extension that had nothing to do with your browser history that had access to it, all of a sudden with a unique identifier tied to your identity was giving SimilarWeb your entire browsing history. So whether it's a malicious extension, an extension acquired by a company with new nefarious data purposes, or an extension with a vulnerability, you have to be wary about what extensions you're installing with these permissions. Going back to the research, when they get to the point of like, hey, what do we do about all of this? They're putting a lot of the blame on Google because they're saying, hey, we're just using legitimate functionality in Chrome. So right off the bat, they don't think that these extensions should be able to do these abrupt changes in icons. That makes sense, but I'm not even sure I would have noticed the icon change if the 1Password, hey, you're logged out, prompt showed up like that. I think that would still be fairly highly successful. So caveat here, the researchers here work for a company that has a browser extension security tool. I don't know anything about this tool or its usefulness. So of course they go on to say, hey, you can install our product and we'll help you secure from this. There's a bunch of companies popping up in this space. There's another one, Secure Annex. I haven't checked any of these out yet, but this is a space that I'm intimately familiar with. And it's a threat that I was always worried about when it was my job to protect enterprises. When I was running AppSec teams, we had an entire team and process dedicated to the approval of what people were installing on their laptops, including browser extensions. The problem is, once these extensions are approved, what happened if any of those acquisitions went down? At the time they're approved, they're all good. And someone comes and buys them, or they're hacked, or there's a supply chain attack. Maybe they're open source and they merge a PR from someone who wants to get their code into a popular extension. This is a really hard problem to solve ongoing. If you're just a normal user watching this, just be careful what extensions you install and what permissions they have, and maybe like set a calendar reminder to regularly audit and get rid of ones that you don't use to reduce your attack surface. Also, I highly suggest setting up different browser profiles or fully different browsers to do some sensitive things versus like a looser browser. If you want to use like some AI tools like Grammarly or something like that, cool, but maybe don't put it in the browser that you also log into everything else with. This is a real threat. I've responded to a number of corporate incidents. I've even helped incident response for other companies who've had employees download malicious extensions, and that's how the malware got on their laptop to begin with. Or they're stealing OAuth tokens or your Okta creds or your other SSO creds or something like that. In those cases, to take it a step further, I obviously always recommend hardware-backed two-factor authentication with something like a YubiKey. They make it so that even if you fall for one of these polymorphic extensions and type in your username and password, the attacker still shouldn't be able to get into your account. And it's stronger than a two-factor code on your phone because, again, they can't even trick you to give you that code. If they trick you to hit the button on your YubiKey sticking out of your USB drive, it does nothing for them. All right, that's all I got today. I just really wanted to show you this really cool attack and maybe go a little trip down memory lane to my Chrome OS hacking days. And I miss that Puka Shell necklace. If you like what I'm doing here, you can tell this is still a really small channel. I've been getting a lot of good feedback. I really appreciate you watching. So do all the YouTube things down below that really help the algorithm and help me grow this channel as I get it off the ground. Like, subscribe, bell, share it with your mom, share it with your grandma. And I already talked about this story in writing in my newsletter that went out this morning as I'm recording this. So if you subscribe to that down below, volnew.com, you would have already read about this before this video came out. Thanks so much. See you next time.